they're mad that the cartoon bunny wasn't being sexualized. And to that I'll say, you guys need Jesus. What's going on YouTube? In this video, I'm gonna tell you why you shouldn't hate Space Jam and probably why everybody else does. And I guess we're gonna get started right now. So Space Jam 2 or Space Jam A New Legacy starring LeBron James is now here. And for all intents and purposes, everybody seems to hate it or not really have anything good to say about it. And I'm going to explain to you not only why that is, but why you shouldn't hate Space Jam. And if you haven't seen it, you should probably think about giving it a shot yourself and not just believing all the critics. So first is box office goals. Space Jam 2 seems to be somewhat of a hit. It has dethroned Black Widow in its second week in the box office with $31 million domestically. And that makes it to date the best release by Warner Brothers during the pandemic or post-pandemic, unseating Wonder Woman and King Kong. So first, before I get into the actual review of the movie, let's discuss the elephant in the room. Why I actually enjoyed this movie and why most people didn't. Why this movie has such a low IMDb score and a low Rotten Tomato scores and is getting killed from critics, fans, and everybody alike. Out there in the social media hemisphere, this movie is getting trashed. I had to think twice about actually even taking the time to watch it. But because I planned on reviewing it, I felt like I had to put everybody else's thoughts and commentary aside and give the movie a fair and honest chance myself from a fresh perspective, not thinking or expecting anything from this movie other than it to be a movie with some human beings and some cartoon characters. And therein lies the first problem with this movie, the expectations. Now, I saw something similar happen with Coming to America, a movie that people had watched and loved and enjoyed for many, many years in their past, in their childhood, in their early teenage years. To wait for a movie close to 30 years, your expectations and anticipation is going to be so high for a movie like that, that is no way that movie can satiate you. There's no way that that movie can really live up to whatever expectation you have of it. And I think Space Jam 2 faced that problem. I don't think people even remember how good or not good the original Space Jam was. They just remember it being groundbreaking. They remember it being something that they loved as children. They remember it being something that they loved as young adults. They just remember being fans of Michael Jordan and the Looney Tunes or either or both and having those worlds come together and being so excited about it being something new. As if they were to make a Who Framed Roger Rabbit Part 2 40 years later, or I guess it would be 25 years later, the anticipation, the expectations, the hype or whatever would be so super high for it, and that movie would probably let you down as well. But it's two points that people forgot to remember going into this movie. For one, none of the critics who criticize this movie are children. And this movie was made for children. Now, I know critics critique movies made for children all the time, and they give those movie scores based on the merits of the movie. But I think this is one of those instances where people are somewhat jaded because they remember how the original Space Jam made them feel as children. And now they're now reviewing this movie, not as a fresh take, but they're reviewing it against that movie. Now mind you, Space Jam is one of my favorite movies growing up. I actually owned like the special edition box set when I saw that they were selling it in stores some 4 or 5 years ago. I went out and bought it, and then I never even opened it up and watched it. I don't even remember if that movie was really, really, really good or not. I've seen it maybe once or twice in the past 10 or 15 years. I just remember I enjoyed it as a child, and I have some fond memories for the film. But was Space Jam a really good movie? Was Michael Jordan's acting good? He was terrible.
What?
Michael Jordan was a terrible actor. He was terrible when he was on Saturday Night Live, but his skits that he was in were funny. A couple of the funnier skits you'll see on Saturday Night Live, some classics, but his acting was terrible, and his acting was horrible in this movie. For comparison, LeBron James is a 10 times better actor than Michael Jordan was. The Looney Tunes were equally as funny as they usually are. So why did people really, really, really hate this movie? So I think I kind of touched on the first part. It was the expectations, the thoughts of this movie being stacked up or compared to the previous Space Jam, which people probably can't even remember whether they liked or not. But the biggest problem is people forgot that this movie is a family. I think a lot of critics went into this movie expecting it to be whatever, wanting to hate on it for whatever reason they did, and not looking at the movie in its totality for what it was. As family movies goes, as a movie you can sit down and watch with your children, be it ages 4, 5, 6, 8, 9, 10, 11, up to 12, 13, 14, or dare I say 15 or 16. As a family, this is a good watch. And now I will get into the review. So I'll start with the cast, and only really two cast members need to be mentioned. One is LeBron James, and the other is Don Cheadle. Now, of course, Damian Lillard was in the movie, and Anthony Davis was in the movie, and Dana Taurasi was in the movie, and Klay Thompson was in the movie, and the young man that played LeBron James' son, I think it was Cedric Joe his name was, and the man that played his agent was Chris Davis, who you've seen in a lot of different movies. I'm not really familiar that much with the young man Cedric Joe. Hopefully we see him some more out there, but Chris Davis was pretty solid as LeBron's agent. He was somewhat to be the comic relief, but he wasn't really that funny. And again, this may be a problem that a lot of critics have with the movie, and slightly a problem I had the movie. The movie wasn't really funny. The movie was entertaining, but it wasn't fun. Sanique Martin Green rounded out the rest of the cast as LeBron James' wife, and you may know Sanique Martin Green from the new Star Trek series or as playing Sonya in The Walking Dead, which is, you know, what I definitely recognize her from. I mean, her role was simple. She was LeBron's wife. She had a few lines here and there, and she was there to cheer on her man. The strength of the cast was Don Cheadle. He played a really good role as being a very campy, you know, cartoon villain. He showed a lot of different multi-layers to his performance. Now, mind you, he was playing a villain in a cartoon movie. So what really did you expect of him? But I think what he was given, he did really good with. He really was the main dialogue and the plot driver of the entire movie. LeBron James, again, did good in his acting role, acting like LeBron James and acting next to characters that didn't exist. Probably 90% of the movie he filmed with the green screen behind him. For that, he did pretty well. I didn't look at the movie like, oh, this is terrible, hate seeing LeBron on camera. I don't know. I think LeBron did pretty good. So as acting goes, I give him a solid 7 being himself. I think he did 7 being himself. People probably would feel like he should knock it out of the park and be a 10 himself, but I think he was a solid 7 being a version of himself in this movie. But the real stars of the movie, of course, were the Looney Tunes, and the Looney Tunes were as loony as ever. And definitely, if you watched this movie and didn't get a few chuckles, if you didn't get a few nostalgic moments from seeing Bugs and Daffy and Yosemite Sam and Foghorn Leghorn and Porky Pig and the Roadrunner and Tweety and Sylvester and Wile E. Coyote, if you didn't get some laughs or chuckles or anything from seeing them interacting with LeBron James, seeing them interacting with each other and some of the situations that they were in and Granny, I don't know what to tell you. I enjoyed most of the moments that the Looney Tunes were on screen, and I will get further into that later in the review, but now I'm gonna go into the plot. So now, spoilers for Space Jam 2. So the plot of this movie is this, and I heard some people having problems with this. Somebody told me specifically, this movie is trash, man. They were in a video game the whole time. And I'm like, we live in a video game world. We didn't live in a video game world when the first Space Jam came out. So I didn't expect this movie to be the first Space Jam. So if that was one of your only problems, that the movie was in a video game, it's not the first Space Jam. So I don't know what to tell you, but that was some of the things I heard, again, with the Coming to America movie. A lot of people said, well, the movie was trash because of this, and I'm like, that's just a plot in a movie. I mean, did you not laugh when this happened? Well, yeah, I found that funny. Or did you not laugh when that happened? Did you not think that was funny? Oh, yeah, that was funny, but I heard a lot of butts, and I'm hearing the same thing with this movie. I see people on the internet were upset that Lola Bunny was uniform was full and covered her fully, and they're like, oh, they were mad that the cartoon bunny wasn't being sexualized. And to that I'll say, you guys need Jesus. But the plot of the movie was the plot of this movie. LeBron James' son wants to create his own video game, but of course LeBron James wants his son to be a basketball player, and LeBron James gets pitched this idea of kind of doing like virtual like advertising, which he kind of actually does in real life. You know, he's got a whole Sprite commercial where he's not even there, it's just his voice. So it was kind of funny that he scoffed at the idea that they would take his likeness, put it basically into cartoon form or animated form, so that he could, you know, pitch all of these Warner Brother projects, and he can do this. And that was the plot of the movie, that he basically laughed at that idea. Now Don Cheadle plays Al G. Rhythm, who is the algorithm, who is kind of like, you know, a sentient type being inside the serververse with a personality and ego and attitude, who created this program, who feels shunned that LeBron James completely like tossed it out and said he was stupid for, like, whoever created this was stupid to come up with it, and it was the algorithm. And of course he's watching as our phones watch us, and you know, it was very tongue-in-cheek with that, like, you know, he said, listen, I can see you through a heater, a vent, an air conditioning unit. It was very funny, but it was actually very real as well. He is the algorithm, like this YouTube algorithm that put this video in front of you, and it can be a living, breathing thing. Who knows what's inside of these devices? Don Cheadle wants to get back at LeBron James, so he sucks him. He figures out a way to suck him and his son into the serververse, and now he has put them against each other in a game of basketball. But the rules are rigged to the game that the son has created with all of these different power-ups and things. It's kind of like an NBA Jam version of a basketball game, and now the Toons have to play in it. So LeBron James meets up with Bugs Bunny. I forgot how they even meet, but they meet up with Bugs Bunny. He needs Bugs' help, but all of the Toons have since been disbanded or left Toontown, and now they have to recruit them. So now this is where the movie starts to get fun, and this is where the movie gets entertaining. Now the problem with this movie, again, if you're a critic and you have a problem with this movie, it's probably because it took so long for the movie to start space jamming. One thing that this movie did wrong, and why I wouldn't give it such a high rating, is it tried too hard to be a family movie. It tried too hard to be a father-son movie. But I will commend LeBron James on this. He didn't put his own family and he didn't put his own kids in the movie. I see too many athletes or stars that get converted to being movie stars or something, and they want to bring their family and their kids and all that and make them actors. I am so glad that he just let actors act. He didn't get his own agent to play the agent. He didn't get his own kids to play the kids. enough for that, unless your kids are out. Because they were setting up this family dynamic, you had about 20 minutes of about an hour and 38 minute movie where really nothing was happening. You were seeing the tension and the relationship between him and his kids, and the first Space Jam didn't do any of that. The first Space Jam, pretty early on, started space jamming. Like, very early on, highlights of Michael Jordan. Not soon after that, he's space jamming. This movie spent way too much time on the family aspect, and then that was sprinkled in later on throughout the movie. I wish they could have streamlined that a little bit and got right to the meat and potatoes, the good part of this movie, and that is LeBron James and the Toons. That is the Toons. So, once the movie actually starts Space Jam, and that's when it gets fun. And I'll say this about this movie. This movie was 10 times better than Wonder Woman 1984, and you could book that. So, one thing that Warner Brothers did do is they threw every single intellectual property and character that they own at the screen in this movie. They were just flying in. It, like, rapid concession, but it was kind of fun to see. Look, I didn't even know that Warner Brothers owned the rights to Game of Thrones. I was like, how did I not know that? That was HBO. I just thought it was HBO. I don't know if they bought it from them or it was always Warner Brothers. I have no idea. And I watched all the seasons of Game of Thrones twice. But the sequence in which they have to round up the posse is probably the strong point of the movie, where they have to go into these different, you know, intellectual properties, go into these different worlds of these movies to rescue or bring back the characters who were in the first movie. And they start with, of course, Daffy Duck, who is in Metropolis, or is he in Gotham City? I think he's in Metropolis trying to be Superman. And that was a funny sequence. LeBron definitely didn't mind poking fun at himself in this movie, because when they get to Metropolis, or when they get to Gotham City, and he's like, I wonder who I'm going to be. I can't wait to see who I'm going to be. And he gets there and he's Robin. And he's like, what? I'm Robin. And Bugs is Batman, which, as it should be in a cartoon movie, LeBron James would definitely be playing Robin to Bugs is Batman. So then they get Daffy, and then they go to all the other worlds, and I had some strong points and some really funny moments that I really liked. Seeing them go get Roadrunner and Wile E. Coyote from the scene from Mad Max was funny. That was a great scene. Seeing Foghorn Leghorn riding Dracarys, saying, "Winter, I say winter is coming." Seeing Granny in the Matrix, and then the biggest scene was actually going to get Lola Bunny, who was on Themyscira with Diana Prince, aka Wonder Woman, as she was going through the Gladiator trials. That was some smart movie making. That was some smart movie making. I don't know what to say about that. You can't watch this movie in a totality and then not enjoy that part of the movie, or say the movie was so bad you didn't enjoy that part of the movie. That was a nice little, you know, moment in the movie. It was some nice moments. And then when they get together and then they're doing the training montage, they didn't kind of rush through the training montage. That was kind of funny. And again, Don Cheadle still jumping in here and there, sprinkling his energy into the film. Again, it was a few things. It was more than a few things I like about this film if you went into it with a fresh mindset, especially if you watched it with your family, which I did not. I watched the movie by myself and enjoyed it. I was literally waiting to see what happened next. I knew LeBron was somehow or another going to win this game. There's no spoilers to that. But again, I enjoyed the journey. I definitely wanted to finish the movie, and after it was over, I didn't feel like I wasted my time like some of the other movies I've reviewed, aka Bloodshot, aka Birds of Prey, aka Wonder Woman 1984. The NBA characters that were in the movie, I mean, their characters that were created were interesting to some degree. I think Klay Thompson was the best one. His character was called Wet Fire because he has a wet jump shot and he's fire. That was really interesting. The character that they created for Dame Time was, you know, it was an interesting character, and they had a scene where they tried to do like the slow motion Quicksilver, Sonic the Hedgehog type deal, and they didn't pull it off nearly as well as it was done in either one of the X-Men movies, X-Men Days of Future Past or X-Men Apocalypse, where Quicksilver did the slow motion scene. Wasn't done as well as we've seen even in the Flash movie, and definitely wasn't done as well as we've seen it in Sonic the Hedgehog. It started off with promise, and then it kind of just like literally fell to pieces, but they tried it, and I felt like in cartoon form they should have been able to really pull it off. But you know, the characters in the movie, they made fun of Anthony Davis's unibrow, which, you know, hey, I got a chuckle out of that. And then while they were playing the game, to see so many Warner Brothers characters in the crowd was very, it was somewhat of a joy to watch. Brought out the kid in me to see some of these characters, even for a brief moment, out there cheering for this basketball game. I mean, King Kong, the Iron Giant, the Flintstones, the Jetsons were, the Mask was there from Jim Carrey, the Mask was there, the Penguin was there, Batman was there. You name a Warner Brothers character, they were there watching that game. And that was very interesting. I'll just say that. It was interesting. So, the music should be playing right now, guys. And for my final review, Space Jam 2. A New Legacy, a movie that I thought I wouldn't enjoy, a movie that I thought would be trash, especially after everybody told me it was. I would give Space Jam A New Legacy a solid 7.15 out of 10 on the Heartstorm Media Review scale, because it nails the one thing I truly think it is and the one thing I truly think it needs to be, and that is a family movie with some cartoon characters. So guys, Hopefully you enjoyed this review. Hopefully you enjoyed this in-depth look at Space Jam 2. And I'm out. Hey guys, thanks for watching. And as always, if you like these videos, you can click my face here to subscribe or here to watch more reviews. One.